Greetings. Isaiah 28:16. Therefore thus says the Lord God, Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a tested stone, a costly cornerstone for the foundation, firmly placed. He who believes in it will not be disturbed. First, notice Zion is where God is laying his cornerstone. Second, notice believing in the cornerstone is a good thing. He who believes in it will not be disturbed. Psalm 118:22, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. The builders reject the stone. God does something marvelous. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. So prophets David and Isaiah both reveal details of the cornerstone who would be rejected. If you are a Muslim, you are conditioned to think the Jews corrupted the message of God. Well, a thinking human being must ask quite a few questions about such a claim. Let's begin with the basic categories of questions. Who, what, when, where, how, and why? Who could make a change to these verses? Who could make a change to these verses in every copy of every Tanakh and every copy of Psalms? When you have a supportable, provable idea, let me know. What was actually changed in these verses? Did they change holy black rock in Mecca to cornerstone? Did the original say the builders accepted the cornerstone? Did Isaiah not even mention the cornerstone and this was added? You claim corruption of God's word. Well, what changed, O Muslim? When was it changed? Was Isaiah changed before Psalms? Was Psalms changed before Isaiah's message? Or were they changed at the same time? Were the changes just after the Psalms were revealed through Prophet David? Or were they changed 100 or 1,000 years later? When you have a supportable, provable idea, let me know. But think carefully, O Muslim, because the reality is neither verse has been altered or corrupted. Matthew 21:42, Jesus said to them, Have you never read in the scriptures, The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Prophet Jesus recites Psalm 118, because it is the word of God. Mark 12:10, Have you never read this scripture? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Allow me to repeat. Prophet Jesus recites Psalm 118 because it is the word of God. Luke 29. Then he proceeded to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it out to some tenants, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants to collect his share of fruit from the vineyard. But the tenants beat the servant and sent him away empty-handed. So he sent another servant, but they beat him and humiliated him, sending him away empty-handed. Then he sent a third, but they wounded him and threw him out. The owner of the vineyard has tried multiple times, patiently, to reach the tenants and receive his due. What shall I do? Asked the owner of the vineyard. They did not respect his servants, his messengers, his prophets. So the owner will send someone more important, more worthy of respect. his son. "What shall I do?" asked the owner of the vineyard. "I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." I would argue, not only did the owner send his beloved son, the owner cried out for the tenants to hear him. Matthew 3:16, "As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. Suddenly the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and resting on him," meaning on Jesus. "And a voice from heaven said, 'This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.'" Luke 3:22, "And the Holy Spirit descended on him in a bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, 'You are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased.'" "What shall I do?" asked the owner of the vineyard. "I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." Matthew 17:5. "He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, 'This is my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him.'" "What shall I do?" asked the owner of the vineyard. "I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." Luke 9:35, "And there came a voice out of the cloud saying, 'This is my beloved son. Hear him.'" "What shall I do?" asked the owner of the vineyard. "I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." So not only did Jesus teach a parable about the owner sending his beloved son, but the owner called Jesus his beloved son. Because Yahweh God, the maker of heaven and earth, is also the owner of heaven and earth. But when the tenants saw the son, they discussed it among themselves and said, "This is the heir. Let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." It is not a stretch to think killing the son is also rejecting the beloved son of God. So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? They rejected Jesus. They rejected the cornerstone. Prophet Zechariah also revealed the rejection and crucifixion by those of Jerusalem, of Zion. Zechariah 12:10, "And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on whom they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and weep bitterly over him as one weeps for a firstborn." It was foretold, so it had to happen. But in the end, God will restore his people Israel. He will come and kill those tenants, and will give the vineyard to others. And when the people heard this, they said, "May such a thing never happen!" "And will give the vineyard to others." Those confused by Islam self-servingly think this means Islam now holds the rights to Israel and God's covenant. I'm serious. This is one of several verses Islam desperately tries to claim God's covenant with Israel has been abolished. But that is in total ignorance of Zechariah 12:10, wherein Yahweh God declares his continued interaction with and blessing upon Israel. But Jesus looked directly at them and said, "Then what is the meaning of that which is written? 'The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone.'" Prophets David and Isaiah foretold of the cornerstone being rejected. Everyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed. I have to admit, this verse has always presented a confused pair of options. You can fall on the rock, on the cornerstone, or the cornerstone can fall on you. Fall on the rock, and you get broken to pieces. Have the cornerstone fall on you and get crushed. Most Christians teaching on this verse suggest fall on it and be broken to pieces, as if the message is about humbling yourself. And between the two options, the interpretation broken is self-humbled carries a legitimacy of consistency with the Christian message as a whole. But what if the real meaning is not about either option? It is really about the eternal and infinite power of the cornerstone. Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a tested stone, a costly cornerstone for the foundation, firmly placed. He who believes in it will not be disturbed. The truth that Jesus is the cornerstone is repeated all through the New Testament. Therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens of the saints and members of God's household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. Notice that Christianity is built on the prophets, as well as the message of the apostles. And Jesus Christ himself is the cornerstone of the faith. Jesus Christ is the cornerstone that God laid in Zion, in Jerusalem. Romans 9:30. What then will we say? That the Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have obtained it, a righteousness that is by faith. Remember, he will come and kill those tenants and will give the vineyard to others? Jesus spoke of the Gentiles, the Christians, that the Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have obtained it, a righteousness that is by faith. But Israel, who pursued a law of righteousness, has not attained it. Why not? Because their pursuit was not by faith, but as if it were by works. They stumbled over the stumbling stone. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." No man pursuing righteousness on his own by his own works can ever obtain right standing with God. As it is written, "See, I lay in Zion a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, and the one who believes in him will never be put to shame." Notice, him, not it, him. The cornerstone is not a piece of rock. It is a person. Isaiah 8:14, "Then he shall become a sanctuary, but to both the houses of Israel a stone to strike and a rock to stumble over, and a snare and a trap for the inhabitants of Jerusalem." Wow! The cornerstone, who we now know is Jesus, is a snare and trap specifically for those in Jerusalem. Many will stumble over them, then they will fall and be broken. They will even be snared and caught. 1 Corinthians 3:11, "For no one can lay a foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ." 1 Peter 2:1, Rid yourselves, therefore, of all malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. Like newborn infants, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, since you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to Him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen and precious in God's sight, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I lay in Zion a stone, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who believes in Him will never be put to shame." To you who believe, then, this stone, Jesus, is precious. But to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble because they disobey the message, and to this they were appointed. Jesus is the cornerstone upon which God wants you to build. Learn of Him and know Him so that He will say, "I knew you," when you say, "Lord, Lord." May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the cornerstone. Amen.